this is such a beautiful house. Thank you guys for coming. It's so great to see it packed, and I hope you guys are enjoying the festival. We are here to celebrate the legacy of TCM's original host, the singular Robert Osborne. Robert signed the channel on the air on April 14th, 1994, and pretty much immediately he began campaigning for a classic film festival. And it only took 16 years. He loved this festival, and he loved really being the patriarch of this channel and really the patriarch of these wonderful films. Year after Robert's death, we created the Robert Osborne Award to be given annually here at the festival to someone who has worked tirelessly to protect, preserve, and defend the great legacy of these films. First, we honored Martin Scorsese. Then, yes. Then Kevin Brownlow. And this year, a natural successor to those giants, Leonard Maltin. Leonard has been writing about movies since before he would have been allowed into a PG-13 movie, if PG-13 movies had even existed. He is a broadcaster. He's a professor, he's an author, he's a podcaster with his daughter, Jessie, who is here somewhere, co-hosts of Maltin on Movies. Mostly though, as you know, he's been a critic. His reviews are known to most of us in his bestseller, Leonard Maltin's Movie Guide, and its companion, Leonard Maltin's Classic Movie Guide. That's for us. First guide published in published in 1969, and continued for 45 years. So, I have here one of the guides. By the way, I don't know what this typeface is, but it's whatever the number is, less than one. So I opened to a random page, and this is why this is such a wonderful thing. It's why so many people became classic movie fans, became knowledgeable about movies, not just classic movies. So I opened it up, and I opened it up to page 1,455 and the Treasure of the Sierra Madre, right? Excellent adaptation of Beach Raven's tale of gold, greed, and human nature at its worst, with Bogart, Houston, and Holt as an unlikely trio of prospectors. John Huston won Oscars for Best Direction and Screenplay. His father, Walter, won as Best Supporting Actor. And that's John as an American tourist near the beginning, young Robert Blake selling lottery tickets. So it's got these rich details. And then just two movies below that, A Tree Grows in Brooklyn, right? Splendid, sensitive film from Betty Smith's novel about the hardships of her tenement life at turn of the 20th century Brooklyn, New York. Perfect in every detail. And then I was like, all right, well, let's just turn the page, right? See what happens. Trespass from 2011. I mean, good cast. Nick Cage, Nicole Kidman, right? I'm like, oh, I don't know this movie. This is gonna be great. The high-end house of an upper-class family is invaded by a band of sadistic, moronic thugs. If there is a point to this unpleasant, endlessly repetitive time waster, it's that the wealthy are just as corrupt and miserable as the lessers, but you already knew that. That was no stars, that was a bomb, the first two, 4 stars. And I was gonna read one more because it's on the very next page. And I was like, oh, this is good. This is why this is so beautiful, because it's a book that on one page can talk about Nicolas Cage and Nicole Kidman, who, by the way, are fantastic actors, as evidenced by their Best Actor and Actress Oscars. But Trog from 1970, which has an actor that we're all very familiar with, Joan Crawford. And it just says here, missing link discovered by anthropologist Crawford naturally gets loose and does its thing. Do yours. Don't watch it. so good. So now I would like to welcome to the stage a man who needs no introduction, but he will now receive one. He is a signature filmmaker, producer, and star of his era, 14 Academy Award nominations, 4 for Best Actor, 4 for Producing the Best Picture, 3 for Original Screenplay, a 4th for Adapted Screenplay. He's a Best Director winner and the recipient of the Irving Thalberg Award. Here to present the Robert Osborne Award to Leonard Maltin, please welcome Mr. Warren Beatty.
Thank you. Thank you. thank you. Thank you. I have to say how nice it is to see all of you. You know, I'm beginning to think that maybe it's a good thing, or maybe a sensible thing. Maybe once a year, or maybe 2 times a year, to get out of the house. Yeah, but I do have this thing, as do you. And well, I got out of the house tonight because I think that it's important for us to protect and preserve what the great director David Lean once said to me a long, long time ago about movies. I never had the honor of working with him, but he was a friend of mine. He said, movies are the great near art form of the 20th century. And, you know, our friend Leonard Maltin, as Ben said, has been dedicated to serving that art form and its history. Since he was 13 years old. So not long ago, he said something to me that made me stop and think. He said, to be a critic, it should be your job. Now, I think that Leonard's 5 decades of experience with that job have shown his dedication to what brings all of us here tonight, which is we kind of love movies. Leonard has worked for many years with the Turner Classic Movies, and it's an organization that has been tremendously valuable to all of us in keeping the art of film and its history alive in the 20th century. And now, in the 21st century, I think as we can see the potential opportunities of streaming, I think movies will continue in theaters. But the thing is, they'll also be permanently available in our home libraries in the same way that books have remained permanently available in our home libraries. And guess what? No paid advertising. Also, I would like to point out, I think it's important to point out that while Leonard has never, to my knowledge, ever asked me to do a television interview with him on Turner Classic Movies, I did see, I saw a very, very impressive interview that he did, a very exciting interview with Dick Tracy, yeah, of all people. And I can't tell you how highly stimulating I found that interview to be.
Oh, boy.
Thank you.
Thank you, Warren. Warren, what a wonderful honor to have you come out and do this. But I got him out of the house. So that was an achievement in itself. All day and all this weekend, people have been very nice and offering congratulations and asking me, how do I feel? How does this make me feel? I feel, at this moment, the only word is overwhelmed. Today, one flashback I had more than once was of my high school math teacher. I continually got higher SAT scores in math than I did in verbal, in spite of the fact that I flunked every math exam I took. And they said, no, well, you have the potential. Your SAT score shows you have the potential. Never found that potential anywhere. So I was bored to tears. This woman who taught math in my high school loved the beauty of mathematics. Talked about, oh, a beautiful equation. This is a beautiful equation. I never saw that beauty. And so I didn't pay close attention, let's just say, and I doodled. And my doodles tended to be kind of obsessive doodles. I would doodle my versions of all the movie studio logos. And sometimes I would sort of do brain teasers for myself. How many of Humphrey Bogart's 75 films can I remember? And write in roughly chronological order. And one day she caught me. One day she caught me red-handed and asked me what I was doing. I said, well, I was writing out a list of the films of Carol Lombard. And she said, I won't do her screechy voice, but that I'll approximate it. Carol Lombard, but she's dead. Which she was. But not to me, because those films were very vital to me. And as they continue to be, and as TCM continues to present them, not as antiques, not as something trapped in amber, you know? These films are as current as the current showing, in my view. And, you know, nobody refers to Shakespeare's plays as those old Shakespeare plays. Or that old Mark Twain book, Huckleberry Finn, or, you know, that old Beethoven symphony. Only movies get kind of pegged as being old when they have, you know, a chronological age to them. To me, discovering a movie that I know little about or maybe haven't ever seen or haven't seen in such a long time that it's kind of almost a new experience, just energizes me, and gives me pleasure and good cheer, and sometimes alters my outlook on the world at a given moment. We all have our ups and downs in life, and not too long ago, one evening during the pandemic, you remember the pandemic. I was in a funk, and it was evening, and my wife, Alice, who to call her my better half is understating the case, but she was going to go inside and ride on her exercise bike, and she said, I don't want to leave you like this. You look really down in the dumps. What can we do? I said, well, I don't know. I just don't feel motivated to do anything. So what's on TCM? This is the literal truth. And we turned on the channel, and they were showing a film that I knew nothing about from 1934 with Adolphe Manjou and a good supporting cast, and took up the next 67 or 68 minutes of my life and made me feel better. Movies can do that. Movies can alter your mood. I mean, sometimes, with all respect to Sir David Lean, I don't think they're a near art form. I think they are an art form. What higher calling, what higher result can come from taking in a piece of art than to lift your spirits? Movies can do that. They do that all the time, or they used to do that all the time. And that's a lot of their appeal to me, then and now. I'm so lucky to, I never planned this career that I've had and that I hope to continue to have. There was no backup plan when I was doodling those titles of Humphrey Bogart in math class. I've never had a plan, and I've certainly never had a backup plan. Things just happened. I was very fortunate. My publishing career, good timing, good luck, an introduction to an editor by a teacher at my school. My television career, good timing, good luck. I was promoting a book on the Today Show, and a guy 3,000 miles away from New York, where I lived at the time, saw it here in LA and called the man who'd been brought in to kind of salvage a show they were trying to keep afloat called Entertainment Tonight. And they auditioned me the next day and ran my audition tape on the air the day after that without telling me. I said, how can you complain that place is crazy if that's the way they treat you before they hire you? I've just had great, you know, great good strokes of fortune. Now, yes, I mean, I've taken those opportunities and done something with them. It's true, but you have to have the good luck to begin with, and that's my life. The luckiest thing that ever happened to me was meeting my wife Alice. We just. We are soulmates. We are life partners. We've just celebrated our 47th anniversary, and early on in the pandemic, we looked at each other one night and said, "How nice that we still love each other, and like each other too." You know, and we know we can never break up because we're the only two people who understand each other's frame of reference. The other night we were trying to line up when did Paul Kelly get arrested, and who else am I going to have that conversation? Answer: no one. But and then we've raised a daughter, a wonderful daughter, Jessie, who has become my partner. My partner in crime, and my link to the 21st century, and to, you know, new media and social media, and we love working together. So we are Jesse flippantly refers to us as the Malton Empire. Well, I'll take it, we boldly go into the future, come what may. I have so many old friends here tonight, and. So many well-wishers who've stopped me, you know, over the last couple days at the festival. I feel blessed. I feel absolutely blessed. And to have that tribute is icing on the cake, truly icing on the cake. And I don't know what more to say except thank you.